So welcome once again. This is the lecture number 34 of the deep learning course, and this is going to be the final class of our this semester. We are going to talk about the generative adversarial network that we started into the last class, but we were actually seeing something very important thing, and now it's time to see the actual things that are there into the GANs. The idea is this, that you know that that encoder-decoder network we are seeing for the last 3-4 lectures, where the idea was this, that you are going to feed something and there is an encoder. This encoder gives you a hidden representation. Using this hidden representation, there is a decoder. Decoder creates something that that my objective is this, that these two outputs should be same. So we are going to use this as a very special thing, and we call it as a hidden representation of the same thing. So the idea is this, that that if you just forget about this particular part, okay, idea is this, that if you remove this particular part and just only consider this particular thing, okay, that is a decoder. And let me give it another name, and the name is going to be the generator. Let me call it the generator. So I am going to take this thing here, just see that. Oh, I forget about this encoder part. I'm going to use only the decoder part. Once again, I'm not telling that it is a trained decoder part, okay? So right now it is also not the trained decoder part. I am supplying some noise to this particular thing. Yes. Yeah. Thank you. So come. So the idea is this, that I am going to use this part only. I am going to only this part. And I'm going to supply something as a noise to this. What is going to happen? Because it can produce something, may not make sense, but it is going to produce something to me. Okay. In the previous setting, if we just go and try to understand for only 1 minute, so here the into the encoder and decoder setting, we had the distribution of x. Some distribution of x was there. We can call it Px, some distribution of x. By using that, we have created some distribution of z, latent vector that we created over here. The idea is this, that if this there is a noise, and let's also assume that noise can come from our some known distributions. So mostly we can say that noise is coming from some Gaussian distribution. So using this Gaussian distribution, you pick up some point, say some noise over here. And if we develop some technique, once again, I'm telling that if we develop some technique that into the hidden representation space, using this thing, you can sample stochastically something from here. Then if this particular part is trained, then it can generate something good. Okay. If this part is trained, this decoder part that I'm going to call it generator, it can generate something that is meaningful. But this part, how to do this part is actually, we don't know. As I have told you a few minutes back, that it is not right now, we are not considering that it is being trained. So we don't know that whether it is going to, using this kind of noise, it is going to pick something from that particular area or not. Okay. But let's assume that there is some system that can do it. Then using this particular noise, you can generate the meaningful images. On the philosophical level, is there any problem? Okay. So using noise, what we are going to do, using the noise is going to utilize to pick something stochastically from this particular distribution. And all these distribution and everything is there inside this particular generator. So it produces an image. Okay. So, and now what is the question remain? If I want to generate a new image, what is the question remains? How to train this generator? Only this is the question, how to train this generator. Okay, all right. We have seen that earlier. Yeah, any questions? No? How to train this particular thing? So there, in this particular setting, we are going to use very weird kind of notation. And the notation is this, that I am going to use another circuit that I am going to call it as a discriminator. Okay, this circuit takes this image, as an input and tells whether this is a right image or not. For example, if here cat images are, I need, for example, here cat images. Okay, so this discriminator is trained in such a way so that whether this image is cat image or not. Okay, using this feedback, I can provide this feedback to this generator and tell that no, your output is not good. Then he would do something and change something, some parameter, so that it becomes, at next time it is going to say one. If it is telling zero, next time it should say one. Okay. So very strange kind of, it is not very easy to understand. It is not a very easy to, there are multiple questions comes to your mind. That how come if this particular part has not seen, I'm telling that it's not trained. Not trained means it is not seen the original things. How can it generate this particular thing, cat images? It can generate dog images as well. It can generate elephant images as well. So how he knows that he have to generate this cat image? This is a very fundamental question. And for that, there is something, how these things are actually aligned, we are going to see mathematically how these things could be aligned, and this could be done. What is the very important part of this particular architecture is this, that I'm not going to specify anything over here. That's why this has a liberty to choose any good representation that can be, that is possible. Earlier, into the previous setting, what was there? We were forcing that this distribution should be very near to this particular distribution. And we actually, our idea was this, that we wanted to estimate this function. So we don't know this. So we actually told that, okay, let us pick any Gaussian. And if the Gaussian, the parameter of the Gaussian, which actually minimizes the distance, this is going to be the represent this particular function. So you know that instead of using the actual definition of the function, I was using this particular definition. And this is not a real function. So that's why there is a problem. Okay. But here, those kind of conditions are actually removed. I'm not telling any kind of restrictions on that, that you have to be one of my known tractable distributions. I'm not telling that. That's why, if it can be trained, it is going to be a very good thing. How to train it again is going to be a very difficult thing. Training again is not easy. You have to be very carefully select the starting point from where you go, otherwise you would not be able to train. So they're notoriously difficult to train. Even if with everything, you will find out that sometimes it is being trained, sometimes it is not being trained because of the stochastic nature of the circuit. So all these things would come. But the basic idea is this. Once again, to go to the next slide, I just wanted to finish this slide by just saying that I'm going to provide some noise. There is some inside circuit that actually try to pick up something from some hidden representation from that particular representation, and from that representation it is going to do a kind of decoder, and that generates a kind of image. This is what we want. To do that, I'm introducing one extra circuit, that is a classifier that tells whether this image is right or not. Okay, all right. So technically, many other places you can find out this figure, and this figure is not very new for you, but I want to tell you something here once again. What is here? We want to generate something. This is our important part. We want to create this particular part so that we can supply some random noise, we can get some images. Okay. But they are generated images. So mostly they are the images that are not available in our world. Those cat images we have not seen. So we can somehow say that it is a kind of fake cat image, but looks like that it is a actual cat image. We are discussing that how to train that, but let us hold for a few minutes that how to train this thing. Let us focus on this particular part, which is a discriminator part, which is a classifier, which actually tells that whether the given image is a right image or not. So how can I train this thing? That's very easy. That's because you know that you have a database. Yeah, you have a database. Since you have a database, you can pick the for example, if the database have 1,000 images, so what you can do, you can sample 500 images out of that. Randomly sample 500 images from the database. You can do that. 500 images you can take from there. And the discriminator, what the discriminator should discriminate, whether the image is correct or not. Okay. Not correct means what? Whether it is generated by the generator or not. So let me ask the generator, can you give me 500 images more, 500 more images? What's the problem? Supply the random things over there. He is going to give you the 500 images. Now you have created this set. Let me ask you that what is the label of these things, 0 or 1? What is the label? 1, because they are from my database, so the label here is 1. What's the label here? They are generated, these images are generated from the generator. What is the label? 0. So the label is 0 here. Now I can shuffle it so that everything is not into the 0 1 0 kind of thing. You can just shuffle it and you can create a next database where somewhere 0 1 1 0 some kind of there is shuffle. Use this particular thing to train the discriminator. So any kind of architecture can work. Any fully connected 2-layer, 3-layer architecture would suffice for to do your task. Make sense? Any problem? You understood that how to train the discriminator. Okay, but how to train the generator again remains the question. We are going to answer this. Okay. Once again, let me just talk about this thing that in this kind of setting, when I'm going to talk about the GAN, we have two important parts. One is a generator, another is a called discriminator. Discriminator is a classifier. Here we do not explicitly model the data distribution. That is a very important thing. And also please note that to train this generator, that how the cat images looks like, I am never going to supply these images to them. This is also a very important part. I'm never going to supply this thing to this generator. We use random noise to map the distributions. How to train? It is a min-max kind of game training. We are going to come to this into the later slides. Okay, so let us see that how we can train the generator. Let me just once again repeat the things once again, just to make the context clear. You say that you understand this thing. This is a hidden PZ is the hidden representation from where my things are coming. So Z is actually going to be fed to the generator, and Z has a distribution. Few minutes back, I told you that it could be a Gaussian distribution from where we are picking the thing, any kind of distribution. So we have a PZ. You understand what is PZ? PZ is a distribution from where I am picking the random things. Then I am going to give it to the generator. So if any Z is given to us, I am going to represent it as a GZ. GZ means what is the generator that has produced. This GZ, once again, be sure right now that GZ is equal to X. GZ is equal to X because our objective is to find out X, na? We cat images or whatever our objective is, we want to find out this. Okay, what is the distribution of X? What is the distribution, real distribution of X? We don't know. It may be something here. There is some distribution because right images are some kind. So I'm going to call it PX. PX is the right distribution of X. But when things are not trained, the GZ that I'm going to produce, it also has some distribution. And this distribution and these two distributions are not same. Make sense? I'm going to call it PZ. PQ. Is it fine? So PQ, you understand? After these slides, PQ would come 10 number of times. So what is PZ? Distribution of the latent that we are going to supply to the system. What is PX? Is the actual distribution of the cat images. What is PQ? My generator, whatever the distribution, my generator is generating. That is PQ. All right, if you understand this, then you tell, sir, PQ and PX would become same when your training is complete. When you have trained them into the right way, then these two values are going to be the same. You want to make them as same. Make sense? All right. So this diagram, so remaining part is this, that if two distributions are there, here, just see this. If two distributions are there, if two distribution, one distribution is this, one distribution is this, once again, I can pick few images from here and put here, few images here and put it here, put them 0 and 1, then put their classes as 0 and 1, and make a database that I can utilize to train this discriminator. This part is clear? This diagram, this part is clear? That how can I create the training example for the discriminator only? To sample something from the PX and sample something from the PQ, and then this thing is need to use to train this particular discriminator, and it tells yes or no. Everything is clear. So we are set to go to the mathematical definitions. Okay. So how can we define the loss? Most of the time, if you want to design a loss, loss is going to be what we expect and what we are getting. Okay. So if we get y hat instead of y, so the loss is mostly defined by cross entropy loss as a y log of y hat 1 minus y log of 1 minus y hat. This we have seen earlier. So do you understand that why there is a mass minus log term? Should I tell you? Abhi aage baat karenge. It would come once again. Very important thing is this, that for the discriminator, there is a ground truth, but there is no ground truth for the generator. We know that there is no ground truth for the generator. I have never shown these images to the generator so that it can learn. Training goes in this way. You can just take an idea. We would come back into the more detail very soon. That if generator is performing very good, means what does it mean? That whatever image it is going to generate, discriminator is telling yes, 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 yes. So it means that discriminator is not good. Loss for the discriminator is very high. Discriminator is bad because we have defined that these are the false images, but it is telling everywhere yes, yes, yes. So when the generator becomes very good, when the generator passes, loss of discriminator is very high. And if the discriminator passes, it is very good. It is very good every time. Whenever the generator is generating something, it tells that, okay, no, it is a false image. It means the generator is in loss. It is not going to do very good. So try to understand that in this particular kind of setting, both of the things cannot do work well. Only one would be having very high performance. Another has not good performance out of generator and discriminator. And whom we want the high thing? It is the generator. Okay. Here in this slide, can I write one thing? Just for the sake of clarity, if gz is equal to x, can I write is equal to z is equal to g inverse x? I can write it, no problem. Huh? Okay, one more thing. That just consider this line. My input is x. Input to what? Discriminator. I'm talking about the discriminator, which tells 0 and 1. That what is the output? If the input to this particular discriminator is x, right thing, and the ground, then the ground truth is 1. If the discriminator says it 1, dx means what the discriminator says. Dx means what the discriminator says. If the discriminator says 1, so is there any loss? No, so loss is 0. Correct? If the discriminator says 0, original image, cat image I am showing to the discriminator, but discriminator is telling what? 0. It is telling, if it tells 0, then there is a loss. Okay. If what is the output of discriminator given x? It could be a value between 0 and 1. Okay. If the value is of the discriminator is 1, then the loss is 0. If the value of discriminator is 0, then the loss is high. If it is 0.9, there is some loss. It is 0.8, it is some loss. It is 0.6, it is some loss. So what do you think? Loss should be like this or loss should be like this? Or loss should be like this? Maybe the exponential one is better because it forces with the larger force that you come to the downside. Okay. So this particular curve is better. We have discussed in the last class, a few classes back also, that how can we generate any of these kind of functions. So what we have seen, what was that particular function? We have seen that, you know, that the function of log x is this kind of function. Here it touches 0 at the one, it touches 0. If I say minus log of x, then the value would be in this particular way. Okay. Value would be into this particular way. And if I say that I'm only looking into 0 to 1 area, so this is the same kind of function. So what should be the loss? Minus of log dx. Are you okay with that? Okay, that's why minus of log of dx. This is what the loss we have. Make sense? Okay. At the time when input is Gz, wrong thing you are going to feed, system ground truth is zero. But if Gz is supplied to the discriminator and it says one, then it's a problem. Okay, it's a problem because a wrong thing has been fed and it is telling one, it is telling is correct, then there is a problem. So at this particular time, we again want some function, some notion of the error. So when the output is one, what should be the error? It should be very high. So at the one, I need a very high value. When it becomes zero, it should not be any value. It should not be any problem because zero, system is telling zero to the zero. At the one, it should be high. So how can we make a function like that? So you know that 0.9, 0.8, 0.1, 0.2. So this value can be taken from this. If the log of x is like this, so at this place, so if I want the function like this, so I can exchange the value which is here, once again, which is here, that is this, to this particular place. 0.1 is this, so I put over this particular place. I just exchange these values. And I can exchange these values by having what? 1 minus d of gz, because gz was supplied. This is the output of when gz was supplied to the system. D of gz is going to be into this particular direction. So this value, if I take 1 minus, then the value would be reverse. 1 minus dz and minus log of the particular thing. Any questions on that? This function is clear? Okay, all right, very good. So we are nearly done. Okay, mathematically everything has been settled out. So what is the overall function, overall loss function? Minus of log dx minus of log 1 minus d gz. This is what my loss function. So I want to minimize this quantity. Once again, I want to minimize this quantity. I want to, the discriminator want to minimize this particular quantity. But negative doesn't look nice. So we can say that make it positive and maximize this quantity. For the different discriminator, you can maximize this quantity. What is this quantity? Can we write it more formally? Because x is coming from where? X is coming from a distribution. So we actually want to, what is the expected value of this particular quantity? Log of d of x, we want to find out expected value of this quantity. When x is coming from where? P of x. X is coming from probability distribution of the x. This part, here we say that expected value of, because we here want z, z is coming from where? P of z, probability of z. Then we want to find out 1 minus d of g of z, this quantity. Make sense? Any problem? We want to maximize this particular quantity. The discriminator want to maximize this particular quantity. So the same is written over here, that discriminator want to maximize this quantity. Just stare this particular formula for 1 second and let me know that you are comfortable with this particular formula. If you have any question, please let me know. Don't see the things which are below. Just see this thing. You are okay? Sir, here is an echo. Richard, whether this formula is clear? Anybody from online? Cool. Yes? Okay.
What is
E? Expected value of. Okay. It is expected value. We want to, what is the expected value of that particular quantity? Because multiple things are going to be fed. So we want to reduce the expected value so that on an average things work well. Very good. So if you want to find out, because we have two kind of architectures where there was a decoder and there was an encoder also, and our generator also. So generator want to what? Do what? Generator want to be good. And we can say that it want to make this discriminator bad. He want to do something so that this discriminator become bad. Okay. So if we want to train the discriminator, we can use the same function and tell that minimize this particular quantity. Find out the different kind of G's. Whatever kind of generators you can create, you change the parameter. For the all the G's means what? You change the parameter of your G. So that this particular underlying quantity, once again, becomes what? Minimized. If it is minimized, then the discriminator would be in problem. He would try to maximize it. Sometimes people say it is a min-max training, min-max game, where they play the min-max game on the same kind of this formula. This formula is very important. After some time, you would say once again. So combined function looks like this particular thing. I think you are okay with that. Great. Just for the sake of more discussion, I am going to call this particular part as a V VDG. Is there any problem? I'm just renaming this. VDG means what? This equation. Okay, let's not go inside this. We understand this. What is this particular formula? So combined loss function that we have just seen few minutes back actually works on VDG, where this is a, again, I have just written to just clarify this. Okay. Optimal value of D. Optimal value of D. If you want to find out a good discriminator, given a G, for example, you set it. At the same time, you are not optimizing both. So when there is a generator, you say that the generator is generating these things. So from the generator, you pick some images. From the original distribution, pick some images. Create the training database and give it to the discriminator to learn. This is how we were training. So if you want to train, means you are going to change the parameter. Changing the parameter means different kind of discriminator. So if you want to find out very good discriminator for a given G, this is your task. So you say that D asterisk of GX. What is the best? G asterisk means what is the best discriminator given a G. How can you find out this? You change the parameter of different kind of D's on this particular thing and try to see what is the best one. Okay. It comes out to be that this thing actually comes out to be the probability of data given X, probability of data divided by probability of G. This actually best that you are going to learn is this. Once again, I just wanted to ask, you understand now, PG? This is the distribution that has been generated when your generator has generated the images. Yeah. So this is the formula. We would go and understand that from where this particular formula has come. All right. So you understand that you started by some generator and then you have made the good discriminator. Now with the good discriminator, you want to find out the good generator. Okay. But now the generator also want to be improve itself because it has got some input. So best generator is going to be that particular thing that which can minimize this particular quantity where I'm going to use the updated G over here. There is no mathematical problem over there. The only thing is this, that this optimization is achieved when PG is equal to P data. Yes, kya hai? Yehi toh karna tha isko. This optimize, yehi toh karna tha. So this is optimization is obtained when PG is equal to P data. It has been shown that same is equivalent to minimizing the JS divergence between P data and PG. So intuitively, you can understand that if both the distribution are same, their difference means JS divergence is going to be the smaller. Make sense? Let me go and give you some more detail on this. So let me write something and try to understand that what I'm writing. Okay. I have a sum distribution that is called PZ from where I am going to pick a Z. Then I am going to give it to the encoder that is going to give me an image. That is encoder is going. No. I am going to give it to the generator. Once again, I am going to give it to the generator that is going to give me G of Z. This has a distribution of P of G. बात किया था ना? This is equal to X. I want this to be X. What does it mean? It means that Z is equal to G inverse of X. We have talked about this. Okay. So what is DZ? DZ is equal to D G inverse X upon DX into DX. You can write like this. Okay. Okay, all right. How can we find out PG? PG is a distribution. If we find out the summation for all the values of PG, it becomes 1 because it's a ultimately distribution. So it is coming from PZ because from the all the values of Z, I am going to generate PG inverse of Z. And then what is the probability of what is the DG inverse Z upon DZ? Okay. All right. Because they are coming from the Z distribution. I'm going to create this using the distribution of Z. Here, I just wanted to give you one small mathematical thing that you know, you most probably know, that if you want to find out expected value of X for the X that is coming from the distribution of PX, so expected value is something that you can write it as an integral for the X. Then for all the values X, you say that what is the probability of that particular X and DX. So this is what the standard definition is. Okay. So let us once again go to our original equation that we had. Our original equation for VDG that we have few minutes back written is equal to expected value of X is coming of probability of X log of DX. DX plus expected value of Z that is coming from probability of Z given X, and it is log of 1 minus D of G of X, G of Z. Okay, and I write. Okay, so if I use this particular upper formula, I can write it into this particular way, that it is an integration of all the values of X, probability that from data of X, that is just an X, and log of D of X. I can write like this, DX plus integration for all the values of Z, PZ of Z, log of 1 minus dg of z dz. You just I have changed this, okay, using the thing. We know one thing, that pz pz Z is G inverse X. What is Z? It is G inverse of X. So I can write P of Z like that. No problem on that. Only this term. Z is G inverse X. What is DZ? DZ we have seen here that it is written like this. DG inverse X. DG inverse of X divided by DX into DX. Okay, this particular formulation combines this inverse thing and this particular part. In between there is this part also, you know that there is this part also. So this formulation says that this becomes P of G. So can we write it like plus summation of X, because we have changed this, summation is going to be X. We can combine these two things. You can combine this and this and say that it is P of Q log of 1 minus D G of Z DX. Okay. Small modification. So in this particular formula, let me just write this thing once again. This part was there, and here V of DG was also there. So the derivation says that if you find out what is the derivative of with respect to X of V DG, it become P data of X divided by DX my plus PQ divided by 1 minus D of G of Z, and then the derivative of this particular term GZ is equal to X. So we can we write it X, and then it becomes minus 1 because D is minus 1 over there, so there is some minus term comes over here. Am I right? Then the definition, then the derivation says that this particular part at the optimization point would be zero. So if you can make it zero, so you can into the next step you can do that. Let me copy it, and we can say that take this particular part here in this particular say type, then it becomes positive. Then you can take this particular part to multiply here, and take this particular part to multiply here. So what we get P data of X minus P data of X into DX is equal to DX PQ. Again, you can take this part here and take the DX common. And if you can take the DX common, what it gives you? It gives you DX is equal to P data it is 0%. It gives you what? It gives you P data of X divided by P data of X plus PQ. So this formula is written over here. How you find out this particular part? Does it make sense? Okay. So next part, that is how to combine these two things and tell that how the JSD is there. Yeah. So there is a notion that you just use this particular representation, this representation. You use this particular representation. Actually, this representation. You use this particular kind of representation. I'm just going to give you some very important hint and homework also, that in this particular representation, you do some kind of changes, and those changes are very simple, that say that I'm going to use PQ log 2, I'm going to add here, then I can subtract PQ log Q over here. I'm adding P data log 2 is multiplied over there, minus P data log 2 over here. In this equation, if I add this thing, subtract this thing, is there any problem? No problem. Okay. So this particular thing you can combine over here by taking PQ as a common. Then you say that there is plus 2 term comes over here. Log has something plus Q, then it goes inside and it is multiplied over here. Okay. DX, we have seen few minutes back that this is the formula. If there is a multiplication of 2 over here, you can take it over here. Similar thing you can do here also, because you have this log 2 term. these two things are going to be, I have added these two terms extra. Here you can take log 2 as a common, and then you say that summation of pq on px, that they are going to be the summation, something like that. Summation of pq is 1 because it's a distribution. Summation of px is also 1 because it is a complete distribution. So this term that I have added extra, it becomes minus of 2 log 2, minus of 2 log 2. However, this term has taken a very special kind of form. What is that? That, once again, focus on this. There is a probability term, and inside, what is there? Log of p data divided by p data pq divided by 2. Okay, if I call this particular term as a m, I can write that p data divided by m. Here also the same thing I am going to get into the second one, because 1 minus p data becomes pq would come at the top. Pq divided by m. This is the same equation. This is the same equation of the JS divergence. Okay, and this term becomes constant, means this is nothing more than what? The JS divergence. So I just give you a homework that you please fill the dots that I just mentioned over here. Try to see that how you can do that. Some example, motivating example, and there is a very influential paper. Now we have more than 10,000 citation of this particular paper, which appeared is only in 2015. Unsupervised representation learning with deep convolution generative adversarial network. Very first paper, very influential kind of paper that introduces something concept called DCGAN. And this is the generator architecture. This is the discriminator architecture. Using these kind of architecture, they have devised a system that can generate the images of the bedroom, hotel bedroom images. So you can see that all these images are being generated by the generator. And you can see that they look pretty good. Okay, if you go and try to find out from very inside details, there will be some problems. But they are very near to the hotel rooms. Using this concept, they had also shown that if you pick a image of a lady, so this lady is actually smiling. So you can say that there is a lady plus a smile. And if you take only lady images, okay, where she is not smiling, and you take the difference of these two quantities, if you take the difference of this thing into this thing, hidden representation, difference into the hidden representation, and you add this to any male person who is neutral, you can find out the smiling images. This is an interesting idea, and it is called the walking into the latent space. Okay, this is another very important example where the same formula that we were studying is written, min-max formula is written over here. So using min-max formula, they have generated this particular image. It was sold with the US dollar, how much? $432,000. So you can also try to build something very interesting. Okay. And many of the images, and you know that I'm not good in that. I cannot appreciate any of these images, but they looks good. Okay. These images are generated by the DCGAN. And the application is this, that sometimes you feed some of the words for the description of these images, and the system learns, and then it can generate the better representation, because you have given only a few things, but it can generate more things. And using those things, you can generate more possible representation of that particular thing, maybe more better story of that thing. 2014 paper, 6,000 citation of that particular paper. Very important and influential paper, pics to pics. And here, on every pixel, it is trying to understand. 2017 paper, not more than this. This paper was presented in my class when I was teaching the machine learning at that time. In the same way you presented your papers a few days back, this paper was presented by one of my students in my class at that time. CVPR paper, 11,000 citations, very influential paper that try to find out on the pixel level what is there. So given the image, it says that here is a road, here is a car, here is a trees, here are the buildings. Then you can do multiple things. You can change the building from this building to another building, this car to another car, this road to another road. They have shown that multiple kind of road they have changed over there. Okay. This is a map This is a satellite image. Using that, you can generate the maps. Very interesting application comes that when the, for example, there is a designer, he designs a purse, and then the people can see and they can change their color and try to see that what is the appearance going to be, and whatever appearance they like, they can order, and then they can produce those things. So the things were not there, but they have actually shown to the user. User has asked that produce this thing for me, and that the same item has been produced. Cycle GAN is again a very interesting paper that actually, because you know that when you have trained neural network, it can do the things at a very fast speed. So there was a zebra, and zebra was converted to the horse into the means on the real video that is being played, on the frame rate is so high that you are not able to understand whether there was a zebra or horse. You can change anything from horse to zebra, zebra to horse, photo to you can images and images to photo. All these kind of conversions are possible, cycle GAN. This is a very interesting paper that came very recently, and 2019 paper. And initially it was archive paper, and then after it that it was actually accepted in CVPR, influential paper, 2,600 citations. That generates the human face images. And you can see that these people are very smart and good looking, but reality is this, that none of them has existed on the earth. All these three images are actually the fake images. They are generated by the generator. So using the idea of going walking inside the latent space, you can use some of the feature of one image and some of the feature of another image, and you can mix it. For example, I take this feature, some of the features from here and some of the features from here, and if I mix that, I would get something like this. For example, this boy and this lady, you can see that there is something. This, you can see that there is some changes. So these kind of changes are possible. All these things are done, and they are very interesting kind of applications. Thank you very much. Sky is the limit. Please try to explore this particular topic. It is going to be very fundamental and very influential problem topic in our computer vision domain. It is going to stay with us. Thank you very much. Once again,